Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the 2011 Claude Shannon Lecture. The 2011 Shannon Award, as you know, is Shlomo Shamai. Shlomo Shamai received his Bachelor of Science, Master of Science, and PhD degrees in Electrical Engineering from the Technion, Israel Institute of Technology, 75, 81, and 86, respectively. Since 1986, he is with the Department of Electrical Engineering at Technion, where he is now the William Fondler Professor of Telecommunications. Dr. Shamai is an Anthropology Fellow, and he's a recipient of very numerous awards, including the Vanderbilt Gold Medal of the URSI. He received the Nonlinear Prize twice, the Joint Information Theory Society and Communication Theory Society Best Paper Award, and the 2007 Information Theory Society Paper Award. He is also the recipient of the 2000 Technion Heritage Prize for Excellence in Research. He served as an associate editor for the Translational Information Theory and served on the Board of Governors of our society. And he currently serves in the Executive Board for the Translational Information Theory. Without further ado, I'd like to invite on stage Professor Shlomo Shamai for the 2011 Shannon Lecture.
Mention something about interference alignment, time permitting, this discuss some further implications of this information, I-MMSE calculation, and conclude with a lab. So the basic chart, a simple Gaussian scalar additive chart scaled by SNR, Y, appears here. And in the Shlomo Shamai paper, this relation was established, a relation between mutual information and the minimum mean square error. That is the best estimate that achieves the minimum mean square error conditional mean. And here there are different notations of the same thing. There are five different proofs there. The most important one is the incremental chance idea, which I will mention later. Okay, if the input x is Gaussian, of course the relations, all the relations here are simple, well known. The best estimation is linear. The mean square error 1 over 1 plus SNR. The classical Shannon formula for the mutual information. This relation is clear. Another exercise, not too hard, an exercise, is to examine binary symmetric inputs and derive this result until we have the class of the Gaussian mutual information, the binary mutual information, and the respective MMSE with that relation. This will be, actually, this simple relation immediately implies quite interesting formula, for example, for the entropy of a variable, x, say, a variable with final Shannon entropy. Since the entropy is the mutual information, but we have no noise here, we have this relation. The entropy is a function of MMSE, or the differential entropy. The very same flavor of relations, where G could be any one-to-one real value factor. That will be not enough for our purpose. A very nice property of the MMSE behavior is what we call the single crossing property. The references appear on the slides. I will not mention them explicitly. What is that? Look at this expression. The difference between the Gaussian MMSE and the actual MMSE, when x is whatever it is. Of course, this is an upper bound, so this is negative, unless the variance of x is larger than the variance of the Gaussian variable. So, if there is a somewhere, what does it say? First, that at zero is the number, the MMSE at the variance, this is negative. Next, that the curve is strictly increasing up to the zero. Then it stays positive until it goes back to zero, but stays positive. There is only one zero product of this curve. Vector extension, the very same form. Now we have a vector chart. Y, SNR, H matrix, the channel matrix, X, input vector N, standard mode, standard Gaussian mode. Here is the relation, the very same thing. Well, here now the estimation is with respect to Hx. If x is Gaussian, I, the mutual information, is the classical of determinants expression, the error covariance, classical results, and the relation at this field. There are many, many extensions to this relation, starting from gradient, one can take derivatives not only with respect to the scaling SNR, but marker 2. Another beautiful relation which I'll mention is the mismatch estimation, which gives an expression for relative entropies, that do. And there are many other properties of the I-MMSE mentioned in very recent papers. Let's move further to a continuous time chart. Here, XT is a continuous time input process. the output sum of the scale with SNR sum of XT plus Gaussian white noise could be written in standard relation of Brownian motion, that's the same. Mutual information, standard definition of mutual information per unit time. Estimation error. Now we have two. What is the cause of estimated filtering error? Which means that x at time t is estimated based on the output from time 0 to t, and the uncausal estimate, or what is known as smoothing error, which means that the estimation is done based on the whole received signal from 0 to t. What about this chart? Again, under the bound condition of balance, the several relation holds continuous time. And the connection between mutual information and the causal MMSE is a classical result due to time. So with those two, we get what we call a triangle relation, here it is, which connects causal and causal MMSE and the mutual information. For Gaussian example, a Gaussian stationary process with power spectral density X, we know mutual information, the classical Shannon 49 of 48 expression, there it is. MMSE, smoothing error, classical Wyner expression. Why go? The cause of MMSE, a bit later, the U injection expression and the relation of four poles. So let us examine some signal processing aspects. Again, just to summarize, continuous time Gaussian channel, uncausal MMSE, that is smoothing error, causal MMSE, filtering error, and this universal relation. Let us demonstrate that for a Brownian motion, Brownian input signal, meaning what? Random telegraph signal, which means both that in interposition times are independent and all exponentially distributed, a two-body process switches between 1 and minus 1, here is a sample of the observation, the integral of it, here, and the resolution still is not that good. Here we have, for that sample, the output of the filter, also the output of the estimator, and what about the relations? The cost of MSE have been calculated by Wolfram 65. Only 20 years later, Yao managed to give an expression for the smoothing error. Here it is. And this relation is very simple. Had we known this relation, just we would have taken the derivative of SNR causal MMSE and we have got this relation. Again, there are many, many generalizations. I'm not going to dwell on them. Just to mention Zakaria's generalization, which considered abstract Wiener spaces, used the Machiavelli calculus for different definitions of causality, and recent works by Dan himself discussing fractional Brownian motion. Another term is the mismatch estimator, either causal or not causal, meaning what? The process XT is governed by the measure P, but when doing the estimation, optimal filtering or smoothing, we assume that it is Q, mismatch. Still, those causal and uncausal relations satisfy the very basic, the same formula, the same universal formula. Let us come to the first challenge. The first challenge, okay, smoothing filtering we have discussed. How about fixed lag estimators? Meaning that XT is estimated based on the signal from minus infinity stationary to be simple to T plus delta. Do we have a relation for that of this kind? Is there a density function, which must be a function of delta, and maybe also a function of some basic features of the process? If it's a function of the process itself, that of course is not linear, for sure. That this relation holds for freedom, we know. This density is just a delta function, and you get that. For smoothing, we know this density is uniform over a scenario. And you get the Shlomo Shamai rule. In general, a challenge. Let us move now to constraint signaling. And constraint signaling is what? Quite a lot of problems. We have the Gaussian channel, the filter Gaussian channel, with the input, additive noise, continuous time. But the input is amplitude constraint combined between minus SNR, square root of SNR to square root of SNR. So take your any input and here we have an ideal clipper, a blue line, difficult to see the blue. So what is the capacity or this balance, the capacity of that? Also, Wyner and Shitz show that the same thing results if we replace the clipper by the arc limiter. That is, this process should be, can be, plus minus one xt, or run between, switch between minus and plus SNR. The question is, can we reach this below the classical channel formula with this additional constraint? Let us take retrospectively the I-MMSE. Okay. The MMSE is of course accompanied by the classical Wiener formula, linear estimator, cannot be suboptimal estimator. Using the I-MMSE relation, here is an upper bound. This the I-MMSE relation, we optimize over all special densities that satisfy the constraint that the input is a unique process, or by the same. Luckily, those are known. McMillan-Shepherd's why go? The bottom line, the main constraint is something of this sort, where Kf is the Fourier transform of a corner positive, not just positive definite instead, independent to satisfy that. Working out the linear with that, choosing a very specific example of a matrix which is corner positive, but is not positive definite, results with this bound, which means no. The Shannon capacity with that constraint cannot be achieved, solving an open problem by mentioned by over and over. Another challenge in that domain is the achievable range. The achievable range. There are results, but it would be very interesting, and my expectation that rather high. Have we been able to examine this random telegraph signal, but now the filter version of it, and come up with a nice MMSE expression for that, low power. So far, I didn't manage to do it. Let us move to the central topic that I want to focus on. Multi-terminal problems, starting with the classical simple broadcast shell, Gaussian broadcast shell, input X. We have two users, Y and Z. Y is the better user, as a higher SNR. This problem is one more. The capacity region of that is very well known. Here it is for specific values of SNR, SNR Y and SNR Z, and it beats in fact the TDMA. Achievability by converse, better balance using the entropy power. Let us take an I-MMSE look here. Again, this is Y, this is Z. Yes, the Y is better. The graded chart, we know the capacity region. Gaussian Bertmann for Swedek, there it is. This is just using the Markov relation, and we contrast this against this. Using the I-MMSE. I think Z is the bubble. could always be written like that. Why? You cannot give half log 1 plus as a null C. So there is an alpha that we have in this word here. And that's of course faulty. What does it mean? That at SNR Z, sorry about the resolution here, at SNR Z, we have that the actual mutual information condition equals to this expression which relates to a Gaussian but with a smaller parameter, alpha. The integral of both red and blue curves at this point are the same. But this cut is lower, so there should be a crossing point somewhere before the SNRC. But we have only one crossing point. That's it. The Gaussian is the number bar that follows the other expression, since IAC, by the Gaussian optimizing distribution, is followed by that capacity region without the entropy part of the flow. Let's take this success term. Wyner chart, the Wyner Wyner chart, same Gaussian mode. Why is it a legitimate user? Z is the invasive. But now we wish to transmit information reliably to Y, keeping Z for ignorance. Ignorance meaning in terms of equivocation. With like Z hasn't ever seen the signal at all. But he has the output. Wyner told us that this is the capacity, the optimization of the input measure of the difference of the mutual information, the great chart. This Gaussian model has been solved using BPI with I-MMSE one line. The difference here is just the integral between SNR1 and SNR2 of the MMSE. MMSE is upper bound by the Gaussian MMSE, and that's it. Satisfied by the Gaussian, that's it. The result. To go further, we need more delicate relation of the single crossing properties of vector. Unfortunately, here we have it only for diagonal matrices. And it boils down again, we have the difference, exactly like in this color scheme, between the error matrix of a Gaussian vector with covariance number G and the actual covariance vector, MMSE error covariance vector. And here we can show in the list above that the eigenvalues of this difference have only single cross. We can use that for the parallel Gaussian broadcast channel. Again, with the input covariance constraint, very similar to what I did with this other thing, to come up with the low capacity. It looks like a success story. Actually, I would like to report a failure. Why? How about the minor Gaussian broadcast channel, the vector Gaussian broadcast channel in general? Achievable region with common rate and two separate rates could be devised rather simply under covariance constraint. We use superposition coding, three covariance metrics, the common message that should be received by the mode receiver must satisfy this kind of an equation because we have a compound minor channel in a way. The message of user 2 is interfered after they remove the interference of the common message just by the message of user 1. The message of user 1, which cannot be called user 2, is not a great challenge in general. Still, it's not interfered at all because of the dirty paper coding. And the conjecture is that the capacity region of that is the union how we order users to select the covariance method. Achievability using that speed I actually described. Converts. No message we know. Wyner than it are. Degraded message set, we know as well as this works. Again, Wyner than it are. Even with a common message, but a high enough common message, this works. Above subtraction, either by In this world, which used the idea of a president, all the ideas prevalent in quality. The best thing, critical rate. What about the rest? If the common message is not that high, a challenge. I was hoping that this I-MMSE relation would cross the gap. So far, not successful. Let's move to an interference challenge. The weak interference challenge. Meaning that A is smaller than 1. So, even for that simple mode, Gaussian weak interference challenge, we do not know the capacity region. Embarrassing, but this is real. But what do we know? We don't know the capacity region. Not in a single letter expression. You don't say it. Taking this and evoking again a single crossing point U of a vector, let me say you the visual theory, rather recently, the recent work that we see, we can come up with what? The known classical subtle bound. Which is fine for the sample as Sassoon's rule. But we came up with that. Actually, what is better? A matter of the last 2 weeks, we managed to improve on that, which now is interesting. Just should mention that also the subtle bound was derived from the multi-letter expression, not using I-MMSE, a different method, by Montahari and Randall. So challenges here were quite a lot. Why? If this is workable with multi-letter expressions, then, you know, multi-letter expressions we know for many problems. Single letter, not so. So maybe other models could be worked out, and actually we did, for example, if you work by Shannon Lecture, that is a broadcast of the Let us move to aspects of good and bad codes. Coding systems, specific coding systems, on a Gaussian chance of that. Coding system, again, a vector, M-like vector, an immutable chart, evidence. Nothing changes. We have this I-MMSE relation, normalized per channeling. Also for any coding system. With that, one is not too difficult to show, but has been shown, that optimal coding or good codes, what do I mean by the word good codes? Capacity achieving codes should behave in terms of MMSE like that. Their MMSE as a function of SNR should behave as uncoded. That is, for lower SNR, you cannot use the structure of it. No, the structure gives you no advantage. And then a sharp phase transition to MMSE 0. If you develop that trigger rightly, there's no enemies here. This is the notion. Here is an uncoded system to start all the way. Here is a repetition. Very nice. We can use that in extrinsic energy charge, extrinsic information transfer charge. A good code behaves like that, input information, output information. And this shows analytically that good codes are not good as component codes for two coding principles, but we use the information and we want to build up information. Not good. That has been observed already in ability, but the inventor of the two codes. Fine, but we are not dealing here with complexity. Maximum likely rather for that good code. So why should we examine bad codes at all? We should. And this is a recent work with Decathlon Kaufman. Look at the interference challenge. We want so far to switch to destination 1, source 2, transmits to destination two. And we had quite a few talks yesterday and the day before, and on Monday. If you are not willing to compromise anything here on the same network channel, you will cause big interference here. You can see the way good codes behave. Here you will cause interference like this was IM. So maybe it's better we stick to a single code to give up a little here, as to cause much less interference as the second. Who is interested in his own message, and this one interferes. How about relays? Not always. We can assume that the relay has better conditions than the destination, so it can decode eventually the transmission. If it is not, what do we use? Compressor code. Why not to use back code? So the relay cannot decode, for sure, at all. But maybe softly decode. Meaning reducing the error, the noise, the additive noise, and then compress and fold. Both are considered in this form. For example, here again, this is the control capacitance fold, and we contrast that with LVDCs with the same rate, which are not that good. Indeed, here they are not that good, but cause less interference for lower SNR. A challenge then, motivated by this consideration. And what is the challenge? As we said, classical scalar Gaussian challenge. Two SNRs, larger SNR and smaller SNR. Here is the I-MMSE revision. We wish to minimize the MMSE, the interference in terms of MMSE, and the smaller SNR, provided that the larger SNR will provide, will guarantee at least this mutual information, where alpha stands for how much are we willing to compromise. Alpha is not compromise at all, then you take the full interference like I am here. Alpha four of them, what's the main distribution of x? Don't know, my conjecture, it is discrete. A discrete number of variables. Have we changed this, how we measure interference, from MMSE to mutual information? Meaning we want to minimize the mutual information that the smaller SNR, keeping the mutual information as at least as this of the larger SNR, then the problem is solvable and we will hear it in a talk in a few hours. But we cannot then come out. We use DPI for that, entropy power. The solution, here it is, one line from I-MMSE. Why? The information at SNR 0 could always be written like that, but alpha is the degradation factor. If it is so, the crossing point is before SNR 0, there is only one crossing point. That's it. SNR 1 is smaller than that, and achieved by taking a Gaussian input, but not using the full power of 1. Alpha. How about the vector extension of the problem? The vector problem, and now don't scale. Vectors of length n, much more difficult inputs, when we allow n to go to infinity. Again, the same future information that we use, the interference measured by MMSE. We want to minimize the MMSE at the lower SNR, keeping the mutual information, normal mutual information, at the higher SNR, at this time. Vectors, non scalars. This is solvable. We actually have the solution. Very recently. New result. And what is the optimization? Hardcore. Not almost optimal, not about optimal, not a few bits from the optimal, optimal. Estimation. To see on the graph here, no compromise, here is the mutual information, good quotes, and here is the MMSE. So at the good SNR point 2 you get a lot, But also a lot of interference of the forces enough. The good is 2.5, the worst is 2. If you are willing to compromise a little with the neutral information, you can inflict a much more interference by half and by actual ratio. One layer is reported here, the other layer here, the neutral information here is the sum. Let us move to another topic, and here I will be much shorter because this is a joint work with whom Sergio Bertuma, my dear friend, and myself at the talk has been given yesterday. And the idea is to look at this problem of interference alignment. We have so many sessions only here, so no need to introduce interference alignment to this audience of its importance. But again, via a different look, a different perspective, using information dimension, the real concept of information dimension, or for this talk, a simpler concept to grasp, I-MMSE dimension. What is the I-MMSE dimension? Google, do this and what? I-MMSE dimension is for this simple challenge. How the I-MMSE decreases asymptotically as a function of SNR. And it has been shown that for discrete, either discrete continuous or mixed inputs, random variables, ready and I-MMSE dimension are the same. Otherwise, not necessary. And why is this really dimension of interest to us now? Because of this. It reflects the dimension, the DOF, the degrees of freedom, the pre-law. So if we consider the interference, the capacity of which we do not know in general, even in this book, to use a Z, which interference challenge is unsolved. And take this point of view, we were able not only to derive many previous results, but to come up with new insights about either the summary degree of freedom or the degree of freedom region as a whole. As I said, I won't talk too much because the talk, the detailed talk has been given. In the previous results, here is a list of quite a few authors. Let me just mention a tutorial, a very recent tutorial that appeared in Foundation and Trends recently, so you could find anything you like there. The previous results are based on number theoretic tools. You have an approximation here. Here the user, as we said, MMSE dimension or a new dimension. The idea is again starting with the multi-letter characterization of the interference challenge. And the main result is that for DOA, it's single letter variables. For general, not, otherwise you would have known the capacity. It does single letter. It doesn't say that it's easy to counter. That has been said. Whatever is interesting is that to get this DOF of k over 2 in general, which was a surprise to start with, but it's not result, one singular component, that is, random variables which are neither continuous nor discrete, and nor combination. And that shows how the number theoretic things of rational, irrational are really here there to stay. And that also shows that from practical point of view, this kind of notion is about problematic. Maybe we need something like robust degrees of freedom. So we were able to generalize that, no need as in previous works, of algebraic rational numbers on the central leads, irrational arena, and also to come up with bands for specific interference, three-user interference charge, where we know that K over 2, 3 over 2 is not satisfied of the error, indigent of the error. And also being able to specify the whole neural region, not only the sound. Challenges may be in the same sense than us. How about broker chance? Broker chance, what we have to study. For example, compound broker chance results show interesting conclusions, but more imperfect chance state information broker chance can be the proof of this proof is Shlomo Shamai legal all conjecture that all these beliefs of freedom collapse. Maybe, don't know, challenge. As I said, time permitting and time does not permit. I would have mentioned several further applications. Time does not permit. I will just say that the incremental idea, which is very simple, that shows this general I-MMSE relation could be, if we look at the dual of it, we come up with many conclusions about microsystems from different point of view. And I cannot really spend time describing that, but would like to say one thing. The connection to statistical physics of this book, the whole I-MMSE relation could be viewed via Cartesian time. And that has been mentioned in that book, also others. And then we understand much better whatever we have seen in those codes, the phase transition. As we've seen, good code, the phase transition of the MMSE behavior. Good code, uniform say over the sphere, phase transition. Superposition, good code, two phase transition. Once we understand this relation, it's much more natural than just from an information theoretical point of view. We have so far discussed Gaussian chance. Generalization, Poisson regime, yes, has been dealt with in Gaussian, I learned from another paper. A unifying view as recently, yesterday, presented by a supervisor that embraces both Gaussian and Poisson. We can generalize further to any independent increment process. Brownian motion, which is the white Gaussian motion, and Poisson as special cases, that. But the question whether that can go further. And here, at the conclusion of the talk, let's take that out. General chart has nothing to do with Gaussian Poisson theorem. Example, Z the general transformation, general chart, Z, this Z goes through a Gaussian chart. Yes. Okay, what is the mutual information between X and Y? We have here a Markov relation, this is the standard formula. But here, Z is already and input to a Gaussian chart. So the general mutual information, when S and R goes infinity, then I S Y equals to I and C equals Y. We have this relation. A general mutual information in terms of MMSE on the Gaussian chart of the input C, the difference of MMSE. And here we come to, and that has appeared already in the basic paper, Gaussian. Verdun has generalized this, or has taken another new one, derived the general divergence between the measure P and Q, relative entropy, in terms of differences between the matched and mismatched estimator. Again, Q is governed by the measure P, mismatch to assume a measure Q when estimated. And here is the measure. So this MMSE is larger because it's mismatch. So the whole thing is non-negative as it should. And mutual information can be good in terms of divergence, you know, classes. The question is there any operational meaning to this mismatch? It's nice that we use mismatch at this stage. Operational meaning can be coordinated. We have a mismatch metric under the code. Why should we use mismatch metrics to start? Not always we know the child. And even if we know the child, we want to implement that. We have three tips to implement the metric. Must be mismatch to something only. So mismatch metric, the code doesn't mean a mismatch metric, is quite an interesting information theoretic problem. It is and has been dealt with, starting with the work of Cesar and Gerber, independently considered in the PhD of Huey, and other follow-up of Cesar Narayan, Balakirsky, Gagel, and Dorteleta. The main result is an achievable rate. Here, given in different words, written differently, here given as a minimization of a divergence expression over a general measure with respect to the original marginals, when the minimization is of a general measure that satisfies the original marginals and some other expectation of this mismatch factor. But just to show that it's time for binary, not to reach an input, so it's time. In general, it is. Let us look at this expression. If we look at this expression and take actually and utilize the properties of a dual Lagrange expression that appeared in the work of the habit out quite a while ago, what do we get? That this achievable region equals to the difference of divergence. This is the magic divergence. The mutual information or capacity to optimize it. And this is the resolution. So, all those are the results. So, there is actually a relation. Is that relation useful? Does it shed further light on mismatch decoding? For example, other cases where this achievable value of 8 matches the corner is tight, at least in the K later extension, without extension, let's see, don't adjust. Okay, so before closing, let us summarize. We have to focus on this multiple terminal problem. Discuss broader challenge, the interference challenge, interference alignment, relay challenge and level, distributed communication didn't mention fact that didn't allow that. Spatial network didn't mention ISI in space, not in time, like the Wyner method. Could be that. Is there something else? Can this information estimation perspective be useful in other things? Yes, it can. At least, if you examine recent results of cardinality bounds of the corpus channel, very recent results, the arguments are not that different from I-MMSE. This you see one of the common proofs are there. How about source channel code? Different relation from that. We have also very recent work, some of them not yet published. How about structured codes? That really find very much interest as of late. Network. And different statistical aspects that have nothing to do with information. One of the things is the approximation. We fail to find the capacity of most multi-terminal problems. So start to approximate a very useful procedure, and David said, David, beautiful tutorial of ISIT 2001. Can this kind of M2, the information estimation, be useful also for approximation? As far as decision and MMSE go, this don't you fail. Decision theory and estimation theory are very well connected, and actually, what the very best lower bounds on MMSE, not the kernel, were found by Zimzakai and an extended Bell cipher, a flying by three via such a procedure. That's not a good thing. But specifically, for the approximation, is it useful? I don't know. But at the end, let us examine, go back to the very classical scalar Gaussian jar. Why? Well, there's a lot of explosive. Shannon, in his seminar work that started our field, gave us the capacity. We have the capacity, why should we approach it? Should not. But Shannon himself did. In an unpublished work, not published also in the collective papers, appears that was not published there. Here, the original frame. Shannon did approximate before March 14. What did he say? For highest NR, I can achieve this with instant on an instantaneous basis. Using PAM signals, Gaussianly distributed, with gray coding, the language of the time, Stiglitz coding. Their probability is one, but what is the average number of bits in there? Here Shannon gave it up. One, the whole thing. And with some minor modification, if you look at the linear detector, taking this MMSE, repeating Shannon calculation, one, you get that result, this approximation result of the classical chart. So maybe it is useful, the I-MMSE approach. And let me stop here. And, as I mentioned, it is not only the work that I have been involved with, and those letters have been explicitly mentioned. So, thank you all.
Thank you for a very nice talk, Shlomo. And I heard it twice, so I have a question. you said you wanted to shape the, would be interesting to shape the curve of MMSE and mutual information to get good points for the freelance channel and things like that. And I think, you mentioned 2 points. Two inputs. One is the Gaussian, which is simple to calculate, and the other one is like digital code of infinite length, let's say multi-superposition or things like that. But other interesting inputs in between, something which is not of zero memory or infinite memory.
Yeah, you can actually, the problem, I of course, the open problem, M here is finite. in general it's fine. It's only for n, when n goes to infinity, we manage to solve it. For n equals 1, we did. So in general, if you have finite state, somehow you mix. It's not this, it cannot be coded. N3 is not a good code. But it somehow mixes between something that you do only through modulation independently, and then the code on top of that, and with order. With that, that's what I have in mind when I mention structure code, which I see as a modulation phase. Don't know single channel.
Great, we have time for a few more questions. Yes?
Does this MMS...
Hi, I wanted to ask whether this I-MMSE approach also applies to channels with feedback?
You see, I said time consuming and time permitting as time going somewhere, but I shouldn't have mentioned that. Directed information, directly applied to people. Kim Bergman advised me, and there are some few other ones. Definitely.
Great. One more question, yes.
What extent do you think the multi-terminal scenarios that you mentioned could be dealt with in other channels beyond Gaussian 1 via the extensions of the I-MMSE type relationships?
Not an easy question. Not an easy question, and that has been formulated as a challenge. Here, this is exactly what Sati Feldman asked here. Can we use this approach to other multi-terminal channels? My first preference is those broadcast channels. And whether yes or no, I'll try the compound minor broadcast channels. What do I mean compound? Minor broadcast channels, but each user can be of this, of that, of that. The transmitter doesn't know what exactly it is, but knows the set and another user. For that, the very surprising, I should say, UF result is that it doesn't matter what is n beyond n equals 2. And that should be shown those recent works. Madali, demonstrated that the upper bound in this work by Wyner, Temprameter, and myself is tight, and not the lower bound as we have conjectured. And that work interference alignment appears, but not with the work interference alignment. So, I would like this, and so far, to say it should really work much like that. If it works for that, then it would be a sign that it's really useful. And then, trying to cope with this Shlomo Shamai project, which is unsolved.
Great, one more question.
You have focused the discussion of applications very much on data transmission problems. Yet, when you look at the I-MMSE formula, it does have a flavor of successive refinement of information because it's an integral over signal penetration. So, what is your view on potential applications to break distortion theory?
It's all
One of the issues that I should have not put in this class, let's see. Here, once you look at the dual to the proof of the basic relation, the dual actually is itself a proof of the IBC, where the multiple access to one of the five proofs. Then, naturally, you have this successive refining, the broadcast approach, either to transmit data, that is, the transmitter knows nothing about the chance state statistic, but the rate that the receiver gets depends on the realization. Appears already in cover 6972 paper, the idea. And when this is combined, say, with successive refinement problem, given a nice view of source channel problem, which has also to do with the Shlomo Shamai fixed variable channel problem. And that is indeed a very nice view that I don't know, at least I haven't seen yet, was not able to derive the result myself. Extension of the current result by, yes, it gives a perspective. And hopefully one can extend it to all, exactly to all the problems that we didn't know how to solve with this multi-layer.
Very good. I think we can stop our session here.